we really think about it, death is the true and ultimate purpose of our life. I have, over the last several years, formed such a knowing relationship with this true and best friend of humankind that his image holds nothing terrifying for me anymore. Instead, it holds much that is soothing and consoling.
In the summer of 1788, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart was 32, and he was at the height of his creative powers. And yet, his life had already been marked by tragedy. The death of his father Leopold the previous year was now followed by that of his six-month-old baby daughter, Teresa, the third child that he and his wife Constanza had lost to premature death.
In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti. Amen.
I've always been captivated by the fact that Mozart's life, full of passions and struggles, fueled his music. Now, the textbooks would suggest that Mozart, like his contemporaries, had classical attitude. In other words, that he wrote music for particular occasions, music of great worth, written with great ease, but nonetheless not born out of a need to express himself emotionally or spiritually. You see, for me, Mozart's music, far from being a function of life, is a reflection of it.
Mozart was getting to grips with the fundamental truths of the human condition, life and death. With only three more years to live, he was to revolutionize instrumental and orchestral writing, crystallized in his last great trilogy of symphonies, which changed the future course of music.
In the weeks following baby Teresa's death, Mozart sat down and wrote this, his 40th symphony in G minor, a work of fury, anguish, and despair. It's Mozart at his most distressed. This first movement is flighty, unsettling, weird, almost on the edge of chaos. And yet, of course, as ever, Mozart shows us he's in complete control. It's a monumental piece of work in which he's able to encapsulate really the whole human experience. The symphonic form that Mozart had inherited was nothing like this. Symphonies were modest, small-scale affairs, kind of warm-up numbers in a concert in between more interesting items. They could deal with one or two little episodes of life, a couple of primary colours. But with Mozart and the full spectrum, he could genuinely express the world. Even at this most turbulent time in Mozart's life, he's saying, "Look what I can do."
Well, that summer was probably the worst of our lives. I was finding it difficult to cope. Pregnant all the time, it seemed. We were both ill. And then there was the money problem.
Even for such a talent as Mozart was, there's no guaranteed income. Even so, quite where all the money went, I think that was a mystery to all of us.
I mean, I know we had to keep up appearances, but it just seemed to slip through our fingers.
They were broke, no question about it. Fortunately, I was in a position to be able to help. But the begging letters used to break my heart.
I have to admit that it's just not possible for me right now to pay back the money you lent me. Instead, I must beg you to be patient a little longer. My finances are in complete disarray, and I will have to borrow more money no matter what.
I've asked him for 500 this time.
Are you sure that's not too much?
I know it's a lot, but if you can lend me even half that.
And that's how it was. Hand to mouth. Puckberg, God bless him, he did pay up. As he almost always did. But we never knew where Wolfgang's next job was coming from. Never knew whether he was in or out with the Viennese. Never knew whether he'd be repaid the money he himself lent to friends. The one thing I could be sure of was that he loved me.
Constanze played a central role in Mozart's life, both as lover and muse. Yet she's gone down in history, unfairly I think, as the woman who corrupted Mozart.
This all dates back to his father Leopold's attitude towards her. He was bitterly opposed to their marriage, believing Constanze's family to be unworthy of his son. Meanwhile, her mother, a poor musician's widow, did everything she could to keep the lovers apart. As long as Leopold refused to give his blessing to the union, she banned Wolfgang from seeing her daughter.
Frau Faber, please, let me
in! Don't you know? If you can't do the decent thing and marry her, then you're not going to see her. Leave my house, go!
I only want to talk to her.
My concern, young man, is to protect my daughter's honour.
Daughter's honour.
Constanze! Come away from that window.
A Frau Faber, please!
Well, they got their way in the end. Despite my father's warning, he knew how unsuitable she was for him. It was good for my brother to be happy, of course. But he just had no idea how much pain this caused my father. And for this, I found it hard to forgive him.
Et benedictionem suam in vobis. Patris et Filius et Spiritus Sanctus. Amen.
Neither Nannerl, Mozart's sister, nor Leopold, his father, attended the wedding. But the following year, Mozart and Constanze made an attempt to heal the rift. Mozart wrote to his father, promising to visit Salzburg, and also inviting him and his sister to the premiere of his great mass in C minor.